Today's video is the first of many where I will be debunking various employment relations related myths. So welcome back, or just welcome if you're new here. I'm Carmen Free, I'm an employment relations practitioner, and I'm also the director of Free Employment Relations. I've included a list of my credentials in the description box below to give you some peace of mind around the content that I share. Like I said, I'm hoping to make a series out of debunking myths, so let me know if this is something that you are interested in by liking this video, subscribing to my channel, and or commenting down below any possible myths that you're aware of around the employment relationship, or any beliefs that you hold that you're unsure whether they are a myth or not. Today, I'm going to be debunking the myths around immediate dismissals or automatic dismissals. Before I explain how this situation arises, my usual disclaimer and a reminder that these videos, I cover a lot of information, but I'm not able to cover every exception to the rule or every scenario. So these videos are for educational purposes only, and if necessary, remember to contact a professional to assist you. So how does the myth of an immediate dismissal or an automatic dismissal usually arise? I will get a call from an employer or a manager stating that the employee so-and-so did and then enter in some very serious offense, and then the employer or manager will go on to say, yes, but this is an immediate dismissal or it's an automatic dismissal. I will get this call sometimes before the dismissal has taken place, but most of the time after the dismissal has taken place and the employee has referred the matter to the CCMA. The employers and managers will also often tell me, our contract states that should an employee commit said offense, then we are entitled to summarily dismiss the employee. So two things here, and I'm going to unpack both of them in this video. First of all, as per the title of this video, it is a myth that employees can be automatically or immediately dismissed. A summary dismissal, as referred to in many contracts of employment, is something different, and I will explain exactly what that is in today's video. Before I explain what a summary dismissal is and how it relates to today's topic, I'm going to explain the primary reason why an immediate dismissal or an automatic dismissal is a myth. And it is a myth because prior to terminating the employment relationship, i.e. dismissing an employee, there needs to be some type of fair procedure that is followed. When we're talking about an employee committing an offense, we're speaking about an employee being dismissed for misconduct, and this usually means that a hearing or a disciplinary inquiry has taken place prior to the dismissal. It doesn't necessarily need to be a very formal disciplinary inquiry. However, there needs to be some version of an opportunity for the employee to state their case prior to the dismissal taking place. Like I said, it doesn't necessarily need to be a formal disciplinary inquiry. However, that is usually recommended. The requirements of a fair procedure prior to terminating the employment relationship for reasons related to misconduct, which is what we're talking about here, is detailed in Schedule 8, the Code of Good Practice on Dismissals, which is attached to the Labor Relations Act. So the Code of Good Practice will set out the guidelines that needs to be followed for a fair procedure. And if there's a deviation from this, then an employer must have a very good reason as to why that specific requirement was not adhered to. Bringing it back to the myth of an immediate or automatic dismissal, the Labor Relations Act, specifically Section 188, details that a dismissal needs to be, firstly, in A, substantively fair, meaning the reason for the dismissal must be fair. And this requirement is often met when an employer conveys to me the very serious offense that an employee committed. Often the reason for that dismissal is justifiable and is a good enough reason to terminate the employment relationship. However, Section 188 goes on to say that the dismissal must also be done in accordance with a fair procedure. And like I said, for conduct or offenses committed, the fair procedure is detailed in Schedule 8. Dismissals related to operational requirements or retrenchments has the fairness requirements in the Act itself under Section 189 or 189A, and also has a separate Code of Good Practice for dismissals related to operational requirements. Dismissals for incapacity is also detailed in Schedule 8, the Code of Good Practice for dismissals. But as you can see from all of that information, dismissals, fair dismissals at least, can only be done for one of three reasons, and that is for conduct, which is what we're talking about today. Those are offenses committed or rules broken. For capacity, that is related to incapacity, be it medical incapacity or some other type of incapacity or poor work performance, or operational requirements, which is typically a retrenchment or a redundancy. All of these dismissals need to have a justifiable reason, substantive fairness, and then also meet the requirements for procedural fairness. Now, I am aware that there have been cases where an employee commits a very serious offense and an employer has not had a hearing per se, and they go to the CCMA and it's still deemed to be a fair dismissal, with the reason being that having a hearing would have made no difference to the outcome. Here, however, I would really caution any employer or manager to apply this, because these cases truly were the exception to the rule. Furthermore, this isn't something that I would recommend, because the resources spent on proving that, to my mind, would be more than that of simply having a hearing prior to the dismissal taking place, or at a bare minimum having some version of allowing the employee to state their case prior to terminating the employment relationship. So while Schedule 8 does detail all of the requirements of a fair procedure, if an employer is not going to follow that, I would at a bare minimum just recommend have some opportunity for the person to state their case prior to dismissing an employee, even if it was a very serious offense. Now I'm going to explain what a summary dismissal is. So technically, a summary dismissal is an immediate dismissal. However, a summary dismissal takes place after a hearing. It is not a automatic dismissal without any procedure having been followed. How the summary dismissal will take place is there will be a hearing or a fair opportunity for an employee to state their case around the offense that was committed or the alleged offense that was committed. And through the hearing, found guilty of the offense, and the chairperson or the person deciding what the outcome should be decides that a summary dismissal is the appropriate outcome for the particular offense committed, having taken into consideration various mitigating and aggravating circumstances. Then they will inform the employee that the relationship is terminated on a summary basis. This means it is immediately terminated. The employee will not finish out their day of work. They will leave straight after the hearing, and that will be the final moment that they were employed with this particular employer, and they will not be required to work out their notice. And in most cases, they won't be paid out their notice pay either. And this decision from the employer not to pay out the notice will be justified by the very serious offense that the employee committed. So essentially, a summary dismissal means that right then and there, the employment relationship is terminated. It is not terminated with notice, and the employee will not work out their notice period. But still, there was a disciplinary inquiry or some kind of a fair procedure done prior to terminating the employment relationship. Now I'd like to unpack what a dismissible offense is, just because it's very closely related to a summary dismissal or the immediate slash automatic dismissal. When I chair a hearing for what we deem a dismissible offense, when I have already found that the employee is guilty based on a balance of probabilities, I will move on to what we refer to as mitigating and aggravating circumstances. These are the various factors that help a chairperson decide what the appropriate sanction should be for the particular offense that was committed. So when I chair those hearings, I will always explain to an employee prior to addressing those factors that that which they committed is a dismissible offense, and I will explain what a dismissible offense means. And the easiest way that I have found to explain it over the years is to explain it as they've committed an offense or broke a rule that is so serious that usually when committed, even as a first offense, it leads to the outcome of a dismissal. But it does not necessarily mean that they will be dismissed. It means that that's the likely outcome, unless there is a very good reason to deviate from the usual outcome of a dismissal. Examples of a dismissible offense include things like fraud or theft or any type of dishonest conduct, really, assault, sexual harassment, and those types of very serious offenses that when committed the first time usually severs the trust relationship between an employer and an employee. Now, when I say there needs to be a very good reason to deviate from the outcome of a dismissal, a good reason would be something like the employee's length of service and a clean disciplinary record, meaning they've been an outstanding employee with no previous warnings or any issues in the past, and they've worked for the employer for a very long period of time. So for example, I have chaired a hearing for dishonest conduct where an employee had worked for the employer for 35 years with a completely clean disciplinary record, and the employer felt that they could still trust the employee and wanted to continue the employment relationship. Now here we're deviating from the usual outcome of a dismissal. And one of the fairness requirements for dismissals is that rules must be consistently applied. So when we deviate from the consistent outcome of a dismissal for dismissible offenses, there needs to be an objectively justifiable reason why we are deviating from that. And length of service can often be an objectively justifiable reason why we would deviate from a particular outcome, and why one employee who has worked for 35 years and commits an offense might get a different outcome from somebody who's worked for an employer for 3 months and commits that particular offense. Just a reminder, with dismissible offenses, there really needs to be an exceptional reason to deviate from that particular outcome, because as the name suggests, it is an offense where the likely outcome will be a dismissal for that particular offense, and that ensures that employees have expectations and know what they can expect to happen should they commit this particular offense or should they disregard a particular rule. Now, a final concept or a final thing that I would like to discuss, which kind of relates to the topic that we're discussing today, simply in that the wording is very much the same, but they are very different. And that is an automatically unfair dismissal. So an automatic dismissal and an automatically unfair dismissal, although they sound very much the same, are vastly different. Section 187 of the Labor Relations Act lays out all the different automatically unfair dismissals. So if an employer terminates the employment relationship for one of these reasons listed under section 187, I've linked that down below if you'd like to see the reasons, but if an employer terminates the employment relationship for one of these reasons, then the employer has a pretty big problem, because as the name suggests, it is automatically unfair. Of course, there will still be the opportunity for an employer, if it is referred to the CCMA and then to the Labor Court, because these cases go to the Labor Court, for an employer to prove that it wasn't for that reason, because it's very unlikely that if it was for that reason that the employer would be able to prove that it was fair. Not impossible, just highly unlikely. So automatically unfair means definitely do not dismiss an employee for those reasons. But it differs from the topic that we're discussing today, which is an automatic dismissal, whereas it is automatically unfair to dismiss an employee for one of these reasons. To conclude and just summarize what was discussed in today's video, a dismissal must be firstly for a fair reason, that would be the substantive fairness, and secondly, a fair procedure needs to be followed prior to terminating the employment relationship, and that will be the procedural fairness requirement. Then the Labor Relations Act and the two codes on dismissals and dismissals for operational requirements detail exactly what a employer needs to do to meet the requirements of a fair procedure. But if an employer is not going to do any of that when an employee commits a very serious offense, the minimum recommendation that I would make is that an employer, at least if they're not going to do a formal disciplinary inquiry or disciplinary hearing, is have a conversation or a discussion with the employee where they get an opportunity to state their side or to state their case. Then a summary dismissal is technically an immediate dismissal, however, it still comes after a fair procedure has been followed. A dismissible offense does not necessarily mean an employee is automatically dismissed. However, it does mean it is highly likely that if they're found to be guilty on a balance of probabilities of that offense or having broken that rule, that the outcome will be a dismissal unless there's a very good reason to deviate from that. Then finally, an automatically unfair dismissal is not the same as an automatic dismissal. And I strongly recommend that employers stay clear of dismissing employees for the reasons detailed in the Labor Relations Act under automatically unfair dismissals. And that concludes today's video. If you found this video helpful, please help me out by liking this video. And also, if you want to see more of my content, please remember to subscribe to my channel. If you like the idea of a debunking various employment relations related myths, please let me know in the comments down below so that I know that those are the videos that you want to see, and I'll put effort into making those videos for you in future. Otherwise, you can just detail any questions that you have or employment relations related content that you would like me to discuss. A reminder that your engagement with my videos helps me to continue to make these videos for you on a regular basis. So thanks for watching today's video, and I will see you next week.